800 Singapore dollar value-oriented gaming PC build guide. Here we go. Let's talk about it. Now, before I start this video, if you have any questions you want to ask, or you just want to join that wireless earphone giveaway I'm doing right now, links in the description. Join my Instagram and Discord, and I'm happy to help with your questions or happy to enter you wireless earphone giveaway. So, do it. Anyway, let's talk about the $800 value gaming PC build guide. Let's talk about the story behind it. Let's talk about how to build it, and most importantly, why I chose this part. So, the story behind it. Essentially, someone basically asked me if I could build a PC for them for their budget of 800 Singapore dollars. And I said, yes, I do this service pretty much for free. You pay for my transport, but I don't charge for the service. I only charge if, you know, I have to take a grab somewhere and stuff like that. So it's a free service. If you're interested, Discord linked in the description, obviously only for Singapore. It's kind of a win-win for you and me. You know, you get a PC build and I get to make a video about it, which I think is a pretty fair trade. But anyway, I went to Simlim this morning, Simlim Square. I went to my usual shop, TradePack. Not saying they're the best, they're just pretty good. And went ahead and bought a bunch of parts and came up with this rig. So let's get into the parts list and why I chose it. So let's start with the CPU. So I chose Intel for this rig. And you might be like, why Intel? Isn't AMD the future? Well, the answer is yes. Right now, AMD is definitely more of a better option if you had $1,000 rig. 3300X is unbeatable, the 3600 is unbeatable, but because I wanted this particular case for this build, the extra cost of this case instead of going with a cheaper techwear case meant that getting a 3300X wasn't wasn't a very good decision. And compared to the Ryzen 3 3100 was the other AMD option that was slightly cheaper than this. This was i3 was only about $5 to $10 more. In fact, I think it was less because of the motherboard we chose. But because the i3 solution was very close in terms of the 3100 in terms of price, in terms of straight out, flat out benchmark performance, the Intel and the 3100, I think the Intel actually edges out a little bit by a couple of percent. Other things as well, such as functions and optimizations and stuff, Intel actually edges out the 3100. But the 3300X is actually by far and away the fastest of the three CPUs I'm talking about here. But in this particular case, because the Intel was only a bit more expensive than the 3100, I had to go with the Intel. It's more value, more performance, more sense. And also I could cheap out on the RAM a little bit if I wanted to sacrifice a bit of response times without losing much of my frame rates. But we're not doing an extreme value-oriented build here, because while it is going to be a value PC, the person I'm building it for doesn't need absolute frame rates. I think he probably would value quality of life things, such as a slightly better case and slightly more efficient power supply than just flat out performance upgrades, like just flat out frame rate, because he's only really playing old games. So those old games don't really need a lot. But I digress, let's continue with the parts. So for RAM, I went with a 32 gig Clev kit. Essentially, this was the cheapest 32 gig, 3200 megahertz RAM set that they had in the shop. So I took it. It's CL18, so it has pretty high latency, but it is not bad at all. It's pretty fast RAM still. Would I recommend it? I subdued, there's no RGB or anything, and it is commonly found for pretty cheap, so it's not a completely bad option. So there's that. And the fact that it's 16 gigs, well, the buyer didn't really need 16 gigs. The only reason I chose 16 gigs was because 8 gigs is pretty much impossible to find nowadays, especially in Simlim Square. And also, 8 gigs doesn't really make sense, because even if you're just running a game, chances are you have Discord or Zoom or Spotify or WhatsApp web open in the background. Especially if you're doing something like Zoom and Discord, that might take up quite a bit of RAM, and you don't really want your gaming experience to be stuttered by that lack of RAM in your system. So go with 16 gigs as much as possible in a modern PC. RAM speed is not really important for Intel CPUs because of the way the design, the architecture, but if you were using an AMD CPU like the Ryzen 3 3100 and Ryzen 3 3300X, then the RAM speed is very essential. I say go for 3000 megahertz and above if you are building an AMD based PC. Now, mind you, I would like to say that my recommendation earlier about the Intel and AMD CPUs is very subjective, because in this case, the shop just had those prices. But depending on where you live, where you're shopping in particular, how much you can negotiate, you have to adjust which CPU to choose according to the prices you can get. Let's talk about the motherboard. So the motherboard is I think it's called a H410. Yeah, it's a H410M-HDV from ASRock. It's an ITX motherboard. It's terrible. It doesn't even have NVMe M.2. So I had to use a SATA SSD and all that. But it works, okay? It sits the CPU, it has a stable, it can run at stable speed, and basically the computer works no problem at all with this motherboard, and it's really cheap. So that. Of course, it is slightly ugly to have an ITX motherboard in a MATX case, but to get an ITX case is actually surprisingly expensive. To get a good ITX case is surprisingly more expensive than to get a good MATX case. I think it's because the demand and the supply for MATX cases is just magnitudes larger than ITX, so MATX cases are more common on the budget level. Let's skip the GPU because I know you're very interested in the GPU of this system. Let's talk about the power supply and the case first, and of course the storage. So for the power supply, I went with a Cooler Master Masterwatt 550 watt 80 plus bronze power supply. The case is a Cooler Master MB320L ARGB Masterbox case. It's from their Masterbox series of cases. It's a budget MATX case. It's got a nice tinted tempered glass side window. It's got your power shroud design. It's pretty standard. It comes with two RGB fans in the front, which is pretty nice. It comes with a LED RGB controller for them in the back as well. So that's a nice bonus. It has the ability to put six. I think you have the ability to mount six fans. And it's a pretty good case. I'm going to do a full-on review of this in a couple of days. But for now, my opinion of this case is that it's pretty easy to build in. It's quite spacious for an MATX case, and I like its standard layout. Although in terms of value, it does kind of struggle against like a Techware case or a Wright case, because those cases are just so cheap. Storage. So for the storage, we had to go with a SATA SSD because the original NVMe SSD I wanted to use is not compatible with this motherboard. This motherboard does not have M.2. Which is a problem. So we put a SATA SSD in there and no problems at all. And it works just fine. GPU for this system, which I think is probably the best part of the system, the most interesting part, is the GTX 1070, as I've alluded to before. And the reason for this is very simple. The GTX 1070 secondhand is an insane value now. A lot of people who are looking into getting a RTX 3080 or RTX 3070 are probably using a 1070 and 1070 Ti. There were very popular cards in the Bitcoin mining boom. They were very popular cards even after the Bitcoin mining thing crashed and everyone was using these cards for gaming. They were very good value cards. I use a 1070 Ti in my own personal rig, and this 1070 I got for $200 something, Singapore dollars, secondhand. And it comes with a very nice EVGA superclocked cooler, which you don't always get every day. So that's awesome. So overall, this GPU is awesome, got it secondhand, and it provides excellent value. And with a 550 watt power supply, it should do just good. So yeah, if you're looking for a secondhand GPU, the models I would recommend checking out right now, probably a GTX 1070. I would say until RTX 3000 series GPUs are out in full force, avoid buying a GPU. But if you have to get a GPU right now, get one that's secondhand. Don't get one that's brand new, because it will be a mistake, because your GPU will depreciate really fast once the 3000 series comes out. So get secondhand, or just wait for the 3000 series to come out, because those GPUs look extremely, extremely attractive right now. That's it for the parts. Let's get on with the build experience and how I built it. Well, I didn't exactly build it. My friend kind of built it, and I filmed the experience. But rest assured, I know how to build a PC. I've built many in my own time. So building process is very easy. Always take out your motherboard first. Use your motherboard box as a bench, test bench. Then take out your CPU and then put that CPU into the CPU socket. So what you do is you lift the retention arm and you align the gold triangle. You align the two notches on the Intel CPU with the two notches on the CPU socket, and then you place it in gently. No force apply. Just make sure everything's aligned. Give it a little wriggle. Make sure it doesn't, you know, it isn't loose or anything, and then close down the latch. Once you close down the latch, you put the little thing under the latch, and then make sure, and it's gonna feel like a lot of pressure and a lot of tension, but it really isn't scary at all. It really isn't a problem at all. It's gonna have a lot of resistance when you push down the latch, but that's a good thing. That means you're doing it right. So push down the latch, make sure it's secure, and you're done. So in this particular case, we're using the Intel stock cooler. So all you have to do is plug in the fan and then align the four pins on the CPU cooler without touching the thermal compound that's pre-applied on the bottom of the cooler, and then press the four pins down into the holes on the motherboard and click, 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 and boom, that's your CPU cooler in. Now for RAM installation, this one's probably one of the easiest and most fun parts of building a PC. Just align the notch on the RAM stick with the notch on the RAM slot, align it up, put it in, slot, click, click, two times, that's my two sticks of RAM in perfect. Make sure they're flush and completely even. Sometimes you might have slightly loose, like you might have thought you put the RAM all the way in, but you didn't, so just be careful of that. Now, once you've done that, open up your PC case, and this is when you start doing the assembly stuff. What I would do generally is put the power supply in and arrange as many cables as I can before I had put in my motherboard. So I would move my 24 pin to the right cable hole, my 8 pin and my PCIe power plugs all into the right areas before putting my motherboard. I will arrange my fan cables in the back. Now, this is a cable management tip to just be at around the right place so that I can plug it into my motherboard, no problems at all. So once I've got all that, I would then align my motherboard with the standoffs and then slot it in. But before that, put in your IO shield, of course. Make sure it's just align it with your motherboard, check that it's the right orientation, put it in, click in place, and that's your IO shield. Then put in your motherboard. This case has pre-installed standoffs, so you don't have to worry about that. You just align your motherboard with the standoffs. Make sure the holes are aligned with the holes. The holes are aligned with the standoffs. Align it with the IO shield, place it, and then take some screws that the motherboard came with and then screw it in. Now, this one is very dependent on the case you're using. You just follow the manual that came with your case and you will know which screws are for your motherboard. And that's all you have to do. Take those screws, screw it in. Okay, so once you've got that motherboard in, before you put in your GPU or your SSD or all that, I would say time to start working on your cables. Put your 8-pin power, 24-pin power, and your front panel connectors, as well as your HD audio, your USB, all those connectors, make sure it's plugged in. And if you want to know where to plug them in, just check your motherboard manual. It will tell you where to plug which cable from your thing. Everything should be well labeled. HD audio should go into the HD audio port, and your front panel connectors, which is probably the most fiddly part, you have to probably consult your manual for that. But once you get those done, sure, while you're doing it, try to keep things as neat as possible. Once you get those done, then it's time to install your GPU and your SSD. So for this rig, I use a SATA SSD, as I've talked about before, and all I had to do was screw the SATA SSD into the SSD bay. I don't have footage of that, unfortunately, and plug in a SATA power cable and a SATA data cable. The SATA data cable is routed through the hole into my motherboard, and then the SATA power cable goes into my power supply. Now, this is a semi-modular power supply, so the SATA power cable isn't already attached to the power supply. I had to get it from the power supply box and connect it, but that's a very easy thing to do, and all I had to do is plug it in and my power cable is set. Now for the GPU, that is very easy. All you have to do is remove the PCIe slot covers covering where you plan to install the GPU. So once I removed it, I unlatched the PCIe slot, aligned the GPU, slide it in, click it in place, done. And after that, I would screw in the GPU with two of the screws included in the case. Once again, if you don't know which screws to use, my tip is just whatever fits should work. But if you're really worried about getting it right, check the manual. I usually just go by gut feel nowadays. And then after that, take the PCIe cable, which I told you to pre-route earlier. See? Foresight, planning. And then, you're done. You pretty much installed all the cables you need. Of course, there's still the fan connectors, and this one is dependent on case, obviously, but in this particular case, the Cooler Master MB320L, the fans were mostly pre-managed, and all I had to do was plug a SATA power cable from the power supply that was already connected to the SSD into the LED RGB controller, and then I had to plug a fan cable from two fans that was through like a splitter into my motherboard, and then I routed it neatly with basic common sense and logic and some patience and made it all neat. Now you've pretty much have everything connected. Ta-da! What else is there to do? Well, pretty simple. All you have to do now is cable manage. And cable management seems intimidating, but take it slowly. Use cable ties, zip ties, tighten things down, and you should be fine. For me, my personal mantra with cable management is, if it's behind the motherboard, it doesn't have to be neat because no one's seeing that, unless you're using a case with two tempered glass sides. But if you're obsessive, you can unplug, replug, and adjust cables until everything doesn't tangle or doesn't overlap. I personally don't care, as long as the final product looks neat and clean on the front side that you look at. Because chances are, if you are building a PC for someone, or if you are someone who's building PC, You're not going to be opening up your PC much at all, so that cable clutter at the back, you're probably only going to revisit that in 2 to 3 years when the next GPU comes out and it's time for an upgrade. So I would say, if you're a beginner, focus on getting the front need first before getting the behind motherboard cable management need. Maybe in your next build, you can try to get that backside need, but just focus on getting that system looking good where you can see it at all times. So once you get that cable management need, just call it a day, strap down the cables with the zip ties in this particular case, no pun intended, the case actually came with zip ties, so that's very nice. And I just tighten it down so it won't be loose and all that. And I'm pretty much done with the PC build. Sounds very simple until you give it a shot. But trust me, once you build it once or build it twice, you actually realize that building PCs is a very easy thing to do. And you won't be intimidated by it. Don't have any fears. And if you have any urgent questions, my Discord, my Instagram, great places to message me. I promise you I can reply in at least a day. Maybe not immediate, but at least. So that's it for my PC build guide. It's pretty shortened. I'm going to do maybe a very in-depth, super planned out one in the future. But for now, I think that should be enough rambling for one video. Thank you guys so much for watching. So I hope this video was either helpful or just fun to watch for you guys, because I know a lot of people watch PC build guides just for fun, and I am one of that. I am one of those people. So hopefully this video was interesting or exciting or enjoyable for you. And if you did find it that, then, you know, subscribe or don't subscribe. Actually, don't subscribe to me. Subscribe to Linus Tech Tips or something. Just like the video and stuff. That's all you need. But seriously, you can subscribe to other channels or this channel. I don't mind. Anyway, that's it for this video. Thank you guys so much for watching. I'm gonna head out. See you soon. Bye.
My back hurts.